Earth is a water world. Nearly three quarters of the surface is awash in oceans, lakes, rivers, and streams. If you gathered up all the surface water on Earth into a ball, it would fit neatly within the western United States.
That ball would be about 860 miles in diameter. That's all the water on Earth.
More than 97% of Earth's surface water is found in the oceans, meaning most of it is salty and unusable for drinking or growing crops. Of the remaining fresh water, most is locked away in ice caps, permafrost, and glaciers. The remaining water would fit in a ball just 35 miles in diameter.
So the freshwater component would be really small, covering about the size of the city of Atlanta.
Water is the only substance on the planet that can exist naturally as a liquid, solid, and gas. This helps make H2O the superstar molecule for life on Earth.
We know we need it for everything from drinking to growing crops. Water plays a big role in transporting heat around the planet, so it's truly critical for life.
Earth wasn't always flowing with water. After it first forms and cools, the planet is rocky and dry. So what's the secret source of all our water? To unlock the answer, we need to look deep into the past. 4.5 billion years ago, extreme gravity starts to pull together layer upon layer of material from space, eventually forming the Earth.
In the early solar system, there were lots of rocky and dusty materials that came together to make our planet. They likely had water, and that would have taken that water deep down in our planet.
But if water is trapped deep inside the Earth as it forms, how does it make its way to the surface?
Over time, as our planet heated, that water would have come up through the rocks of our planet, ultimately leaking out of our volcanoes. Initially as steam that then came out into their atmosphere and cooled to form liquid water droplets.
In addition to water rising up from the Earth's mantle, it falls down from above.
Later on, we have additional water brought to our surface by water-rich asteroids, but also by comets, big balls of ice containing vast quantities of water.
Our primeval oceans weren't salty, but over millennia, as rain falls and rivers begin to run, the flowing water scours surface rocks, eroding away salts and minerals and delivering them to the sea. This continues today, with all the rivers in the world discharging a combined 4 billion tons of salts into the oceans every year.
The rivers on our planet don't turn salty because they are constantly replenished by rainfall falling on the mountains and flowing out to the sea. But as that water runs out to the sea, carrying all the salty materials from our crust, our ocean fills up with them, and it has no outlet to go to, so our oceans become saltier over time.
This flow from rivers to oceans is one part of Earth's water cycle. This critical process takes advantage of water's ability to transform.
When we're thinking about the water cycle, we often think about it starting with the process of evaporation.
When heated by the sun, water evaporates, changing into a vapor. As it rises and cools, the vapor will eventually return to Earth as rain. But it needs to find a secret ingredient first. To form, each raindrop must condense around a microscopic floating particle called a condensation nuclei.
These condensation nuclei can be anything from dust to volcanic ash to smoke to sea salts to pollutants. They are really tiny. They're about 1/100th the size of a strand of human hair. And the air is full of them.
What you see as clouds are actually millions of water droplets condensed around these tiny particles. When the droplets reach about a millimeter in size, gravity takes over.
Over time, those droplets will grow until eventually gravity is strong enough to pull them down to Earth's surface as precipitation. That precipitation that falls can then end up in a river, run off back to the oceans, and the cycle can repeat itself.